Good afternoon, everyone. Welcome to the annual technical review workshop for the San Onofre Nuclear Generating Station, or SONGS, Wheeler North Reef Mitigation Project. My name is Jonna Engel, and I am an Environmental Program Manager for the Coastal Commission Ecology Group and part of the SONGS mitigation team. In addition to myself and Dr. Lori Cotin from the Commission, other members of the team on Zoom today include Commission contract scientists, Commission science advisory panel scientists, and Southern California Edison managers and scientists. The purpose of the workshop is to provide an opportunity for information exchange among all interested parties. No regulatory decisions will be made on the mitigation project at this workshop. Commission staff does consider the annual monitoring results in carrying out its oversight of the mitigation project. Before I turn it over to the Commission contract scientists, I want to go over a few logistical items related to the Zoom platform and describe how we will run the webinar. We are recording this webinar and will post the recording to the UCSB SONGS mitigation website. Everyone attending the webinar has been muted and will remain muted during the presentations. Video has been disabled for all attendees. During the question and answer portion of the webinar, if you have a question for anyone on the team, there will be two ways to ask your question. First, you can type a question into the Q&A box at the bottom of your Zoom screen. When we come to the question and answer time, the team will walk through the questions and answer them verbally. Second, when we come to the question and answer time, you can use the raise your hand function, also at the bottom of your Zoom screen, to indicate that you would like to ask a question. We will then unmute you one at a time to ask your question. So now I will turn it over to Dr. Dan Reed.
Okay. Thanks, Jonna. As Jonna mentioned, I'm Dan Reed. I'm a research biologist at UC Santa Barbara, and I'd like to begin the webinar with a brief introduction to the SONGS Reef Mitigation Program, which is one component of a comprehensive mitigation program designed to compensate for the loss or damage of marine resources caused by the operation of SONGS. Another large component of this mitigation program is a wetland restoration project that is being done at San Dieguito Lagoon. We won't be talking about that today. However, there is a similar webinar workshop planned for the wetland project that will be on May 2nd next month. And you can sign up for that webinar at our website, which is shown here. Okay, let's see here. So by way of introduction then, I'd like to begin with a brief description of the SONGS single pass seawater cooling system, which is essentially the cause for all the marine related impacts caused by SONGS. And each unit, units two and three, both have a single their own separate seawater cooling system that consists of an 18-foot diameter intake pipe located approximately a half mile offshore in about 30 feet of water. Diameter of those pipes is shown in that wow. Top right-hand photo. The water is taken into the power plant where it's used to cool the nuclear reactors. And both units, when the plant was operating at full operations, brought in a volume of water that was 2.4 billion gallons a day, and that's roughly equivalent to a cube that has the dimensions of a mile on each side, about 12 feet deep. Okay, so that water, once it comes into the plant, it's used to cool the reactors, and it's heated about 19 degrees Fahrenheit above ambient. It's then discharged back out into the ocean through these discharge lines, a line for Unit two is about 6,000 feet long, and the one for unit three is about 8,600 feet long, and they extend back offshore. The last 2,500 feet of each diffuser line consist of 63 different diffuser ports, which are designed to rapidly mix the heated effluent with the surrounding seawater to cool it. And the reef mitigation project is related to the adverse impacts of this discharge of cooling water on the San Onofre kelp forest, which is located directly offshore of the power plant. You can see in this image here that there's a large turbidity plume associated with those intake pipes. And the Coastal Commission commissioned a committee, the Marine Review Committee, to do intensive studies from the period 1976 through 1987 to actually determine what the impacts of this cooling water system were on living marine resources. And they determined that this effluent, this turbidity plume, was responsible for causing a substantial reduction in the size of the San Onofre kelp forest. Okay, well, this California Coastal Act requires mitigation of marine impacts such as the one caused at the San Onofre kelp forest. And the California Coastal Commission is the agency that's responsible for implementing the Coastal Act. So to mitigate for the impacts to the San Onofre kelp forest caused by songs, the Coastal Commission amended Southern California Edison's coastal development permit to operate songs by adding a couple requirements. And first, they required Edison to construct an artificial reef that was large enough to support at least 28 tons of reef fish and 150 acres of kelp forest habitat to compensate for the losses of kelp and kelp bed fish, invertebrates, and algae. Another important requirement that the commission put into the amended permit was for Edison to provide funding and scientific oversight of the monitoring of the artificial reef mitigation that was independent of Edison. And that is being done through a contract with the Marine Science Institute at the University of California at Santa Barbara. And this is our mitigation team. It consists of a group of project investigators who are largely responsible for directing the various elements of the mitigation program, for reporting the results of that program to the commission and to the general public. We also have a very talented and dedicated group of scientific staff that are largely responsible for collecting and managing those data. And we have a science advisory panel that kind of keeps us on our toes and ensures that not only the science we do is very sound, but also that it's consistent with the intent and requirements of the SONGS Coastal Development Permit. The objective of the project, the overall objective, is to replace the marine resources that were damaged or lost in the San Onofre kelp forest due to the operations of SONGS Units 2 and 3. And as many of you know, Units 2 and 3 stopped operating or producing electricity in 2012-2013. But the way that the mitigation requirement is written, it requires that the impacts that occurred during the 30 years that the power plant was operating, or 32 years, that the mitigation is intended to replace those resources for a period of time equal to that operating life. And we take a five-step approach to this mitigation project. And the first approach involved designing an artificial reef in sandy habitat that was low relief with a topography and depth similar to that of the San Onofre kelp forest where the resources were lost. The idea was to locate this artificial reef near Songs, near the San Onofre kelp forest, again, where the resources were lost, but outside of the influence of the discharge of Songs. The intent was to construct the artificial reef in two phases, the first phase being a small, relatively short-term experimental phase that was intended to test different reef materials and reef designs, with the idea that information derived from that five-year experiment would be used to design a much larger mitigation phase that would be evaluated for a much longer period of time, and it would be designed to replace the kelp forest resources that were lost at San Onofre. As I mentioned before, the monitoring of the artificial reef was an important component of this project, and it's done to measure the success of the reef based on performance standards that were developed by the Coastal Commission that are used to ensure that the project objective is being met. And if that objective is not being met, if those standards are not being met, then there's a clause in the permit for the commission to impose corrective measures that will remediate the artificial reef so that it will meet those performance standards in the future. And then the last step in the process is the end of project monitoring and oversight. And that will occur after the mitigation requirement is met. That means after the 32 years of resource loss have been fully compensated for. This is a map showing the project site and the two different phases of the Wheeler North Reef. Phase one consisted of a total of 25 acres. It was built in 1999. It's shown as these dark pink squares that are 40 meters by 40 meters on a side. There's a total of 56 of them arranged in seven blocks of eight, each consisting of different reef designs and reef materials. In the phase two reef consists of these 18 large green polygons of varying size and shapes that comprised a total of 150 acres, and that was constructed in 2008. And together, the phase one and phase two reef comprise 175-acre Wheeler North Reef. And it's named after Wheeler North as a famous marine biologist who many consider be the sort of the grandfather of kelp forest ecology. So the artificial reef was named in his honor. These are just some images taken on the artificial reef that show some of the more charismatic fauna and flora. I mean, I think of kelp as being charismatic. There's some pictures of it, but it includes things like sand bass and kelp bass and spiny lobster, which are, you know, highly valued in their own right for recreational and commercial purposes, but also giant sea bass, which are an endangered species that have been making a comeback in Southern California in recent years and are common visitors to the artificial reef. Well, the monitoring began in 2009, and it showed that while the Wheeler North Reef was largely performing very similar to natural reefs in the region, the data showed that it was just too small to consistently meet the performance standards for fish standing stock in kelp, giant kelp area. So in 2016, then, the Coastal Commission required Southern California Edison to remediate the Wheeler North Reef by adding up to 210 new acres of low relief reef. And this is referred to as the phase three expansion. And this is a map showing where that expansion occurred, the phase three polygons. There's a total of 20 of them. They're shown in white here. And they were placed, some of them were placed on the inshore southern edge of the existing reef, the existing phase one and phase two reef. Well, the remainder was placed to the north of the existing reef. They comprised a total of 198 acres of low relief boulder rock that was designed very much similar to the phase two reef. Collectively, all three phases comprise 373 acres. It extends across a length of coastline about 4.5 miles, making it one of the largest artificial reefs of its kind in the world. Okay, I mentioned the monitoring. The purpose of the monitoring is to determine whether or not the Wheeler North Reef is meeting the required project goals. And these are really measured as in terms of meeting performance standards. We have a total of 149 sampling stations that are distributed across all three phases of the Wheeler North Reef. They're shown as these black lines and the polygons here. Each station is defined as a differential GPS coordinate and a compass heading, and each station is sampled once a year, beginning in summer and extending into early fall. The sampling design consists of different types of sampling units that are used to sample different kinds of organisms. Fish, for instance, are sampled along a 3-meter wide swath that runs along the 50-meter transect. It's shown as this dash box in here, and fish are counted from the bottom up to 1.5 meters off the bottom. Giant kelp and other large algae and mobile invertebrates are counted in five 10 meter by 2 meter plots that are located uniformly, a space 10 meters along the transect. Within each of those large plots, there's a one square meter plot. And in that plot, we estimate the percent cover of sessile organisms, sessile algae and invertebrates, and also the percent cover of different types of substrate. Also within that 1 meter plot, we count smaller algae and vertebrates and cryptic fish. And we either do that in the whole square meter plot or in half that plot, depending on the size and abundance of those organisms. And you can actually find a lot more information about our project. We have a newly developed or revised project website, and it reports has a lot of information on background and on history of the project, as well as status of the current projects. An important addition to the website is we have a data catalog on the website. And in this data catalog, we are making the monitoring data publicly available through the National Science Foundation's Environmental Data Initiative, the data portal of that. At present, we have all the wetland data that have been posted to that website, and we hope to have the reef data available to the public within the next month or two. We also have a library that contains a variety of different types of project-related documents, and the library is set up so that you can actually browse these documents by year, by the mitigation project type, by author, and also by the type of documents. The kinds of documents include annual reports that we put out every year, these workshop webinar presentations are there. We have various construction reports and as well as a variety of different types of permits and regulatory documents. And lastly, you can subscribe to our mailing list on the front page of our website. There's a place you can subscribe to our mailing list, or you can follow us on Instagram or contact us via phone or email. So we're pretty easy to get a hold of. And with that, rather than take questions right now, what I'd like to do is introduce Steve Schroeder for our next presentation. And Steve's gonna talk about last year's monitoring results and how the Wheeler North Reef performed last year. So, and after Steve's talk, we'll have a period of question and answer session. And then we'll have another talk followed by Kat Behesti, who will talk about patterns of species abundance on the reef. And we'll conclude with another question and answer session. And we'll be here as long as there's questions to answer. So with that, I'd like to turn it over to Steve Schroeder.
We evaluate the performance of the Wheeler North Reef using both biological and physical standards, and there are two types of performance standards. There are relative standards at the Wheeler North Reef that must be similar to natural reefs in the region, and there are absolute standards that are measured against a fixed value at the Wheeler North Reef only. Okay. The rationale for our monitoring is that to be successful, the Wheeler North Reef must sustain a kelp forest community that is similar to those at the natural reefs in the region. And for this, we need to choose reference sites. The criteria for choosing the natural reference reefs is that they have a history of sustaining giant kelp. They occur at a depth similar to that of the artificial reef. They are primarily of low relief, preferably consisting of cobbles and boulders, and they are actually similar to the relief of the San Onofre kelp bed, the kelp forest that was impacted by songs, and that they are located within the local region. Two kelp forests fulfill these criteria. The San Mateo kelp bed, it's shown just south of the Wheeler North Reef, and the barn kelp bed is about 12 and a half kilometers south of the Wheeler North Reef, and you can see location of the power plant songs at the white dot, and then the two reference reefs are the green dots. So to be similar, the four-year running average for a relative performance standard, the Wheeler North Reef must not be significantly less than that at the reference reef, having the lowest value for that particular performance standard. And the rationale for this is that for a given performance standard, the Wheeler North Reef should perform at least as well as the lowest performing reference reef. The biological characteristics of a reef, whether it be natural or artificial, fluctuate over time. And a four-year running average takes this variability into account when we evaluate the reef's performance. COVID-19 had a major impact on our monitoring activities. University-sponsored research was shut down from mid-March to mid-July in 2020. And this caused a number of the phase one and two sampling stations to be reduced from 92, which are shown as the black lines, to 15, which are shown as the yellow dots. This reduced sampling increased uncertainty in assessing some performance standards. And as a result, the 2020 data were excluded from the four-year running average used to evaluate many of the performance standards in 2021. For example, for some of the standards, the running average was based only on data collected in 2018, 2019, and 2021. There are 11 relative performance standards for the Wheeler North Reef. Five of these standards have to do with the benthic community of algae and mobile and sessile invertebrates. Another five standards have to do with the fish assemblage on the reef. And there's a final relative standard called food chain support that measures the extent to which the benthic community supports the fish community. And so the next few slides are going to go over the results from for these various performance standards, and they're going to have the same format. So on the left-hand side of these slides are the annual values for each of the reefs. The barn kelp is shown as the blue square, San Mateo kelp is the red circle, and the Wheeler North Reef as the green upper pointing triangle. And on the right side are graphs that show the running averages. And so I'm going to start with the performance standard for macroalgae. And the requirement is the percent cover and number of species of algae must be similar to natural reefs within the region. So on the top left panel, we see the time series for the percent cover of macroalgae, understory macroalgae. And you can see that a year after construction, Wheeler North Reef had a value that was intermediate between the two reference sites, but thereafter it was consistently lower. And so the running average in 2021 shows that Wheeler North Reef was substantially and significantly below that of the two reference reefs. So this standard was not met in 2021. The bottom graphs show the number of species of algae per transect. And this is the annual time series pattern was similar to that we saw for the percent cover, similar to the two reference reefs in 2009, but then thereafter consistently lower than that at the two reference reefs. In 2021, the running average for the Wheeler North Reef was significantly below the two reference reefs, and so this standard also was not met. Next, I want to turn to invertebrates. And the top two panels show the percent cover of sessile invertebrates. In contrast to the algae, sessile invertebrates cover was lower in 2009, but from 2010 on was either higher or within the range of the two reference reefs. And so the running average for 2021 was at the Wheeler North Reef was higher than the two reference reefs. And so this standard was met. The bottom two panels show the density of mobile invertebrates. And the pattern for mobile invertebrates, the annual pattern for mobile invertebrates was actually similar to that seen by for the sessile invertebrates, starting low in 2009 and then either above or within the values seen at the two reference reefs. In 2021, the density of mobile invertebrates was midway between the two reference reefs. So this standard was also missed. So these standards were met in 2021 for sessile invertebrates and mobile invertebrates. And then we have a standard that deals with the number of species of invertebrates that need to be similar to natural reference reefs within the region. And this graph shows that initially the number of sessile invertebrates at the Wheeler North Reef was quite a bit lower than at the two reference reefs. But from 2010 on, the values were generally within values seen at the two reference reefs. And if we look at the running average for 2021, we see that Wheeler North Reef is in between values as seen at the two reference reefs. So this standard was met in 2021. Next, I'm going to turn to standards for fish. And these standards on this graph show deal with the abundances of resident and young of year fish that must be similar to natural reefs within the region. The top panels show the density number per 100 meters squared of resident fish, that is to say fish on the reef that are greater than a year old. And what you can see is that values at the Wheeler North Reef were pretty much within values seen at the two reference reefs. There was a large spike in fish abundance in 2011 at the barn kelp, and this was due to an unusually large school of señorita. Running average in 2021 for resident fish at Wheeler North was intermediate between the two reference reefs, higher than San Mateo, lower than barn kelp, and this standard was met for resident fish. If we turn next to young of year fish, densities of young of year fish were generally similar to those at Wheeler North Reef. Fluctuated fairly substantially. In 2016, abundances declined dramatically at all three reefs. If we look at the running average for young of year fish, Wheeler North Reef was averaged higher than the two reference reefs, and so this standard was met. So both the standard for resident fish and young of year fish was met in 2021. Turning now to the number of species of fish, both resident and young of year fish. And you can see on the left that the number of species of resident and young of year fish at the Wheeler North Reef were intermediate between the two reference reefs for pretty much all of the years. And this was also the case for the running average in 2021. Where Wheeler North Reef was greater than number of species at Wheeler North Reef was greater at than at San Mateo and less than at the barn kelp. And so this standard was met in 2021. And the next standard has to do with the production of reef fish. And production of reef fish is measured in grams per meter squared per year. And it is based on data on fish size and fish density collected at all the quadrats and then scaled to the amount of production per unit area of reef. And what you can see in the bottom lower left graph is that the value of production for fish production on the Wheeler North Reef was intermediate between the values at the two reference reefs. Production was very high in 2011 at the barn kelp, and this was due to the fact that all of the species of fish that are used to assess production were unusually high at barn kelp in that year. If we look at the 3-year running average in 2021, we also see that the production of fish was intermediate between the two reference reefs at the Wheeler North Reef, and this standard was met in 2021. Next, I'm turned to the fish reproduction, And fish reproduction is measured by the production of eggs in three species of female fish and three species of fish on the reef. And we use what we call a fecundity index, which is scaled. Egg production is scaled to the body size of the fish and is averaged amongst all three species of fish that we use. There's the fish that we use are the kelp bass. The kelp bass, señorita, and California sheephead. You can see that fish production, generally speaking, was either a little bit higher or a little bit or within the values seen at the Wheeler North Reef throughout the time series. And for the running average in 2021, we see that the reproductive fish reproduction at Wheeler North Reef was actually greater than the two reference reefs. So this standard was met in 2021. Excuse me, okay, wait a minute. Okay, so the final relative standard is what we call food chain support. And that is the extent to which the benthic community supports the fish community on the reef. And we measure this by looking at the amount of food in the guts of species. And we look at two species for this, the a black surf perch and the California sheephead. And you can see that there's a lot of variability in this food chain support measure over the years. Sometimes Wheeler North is below, sometimes it's in some cases it's above, and generally speaking, it's in between values seen at the Wheeler North Reef. When we look at the running average in 2021, we see that the food chain support was actually greater at the Wheeler North Reef than the two reference reefs. And so this standard was met in 2021. Okay, so how do we evaluate these relative performance standards? The Wheeler North Reef must meet as many relative standards as the lowest performing reference reef in a given year for that year to count towards mitigation credit. And the rationale for this is that requiring to meet with the Wheeler North Reef to meet at least as many relative standards as the reference reefs achieves the desired goal of mitigation, that the Wheeler North Reef be similar to the natural reefs without requiring it to be consistently better. Wheeler North Reef and the reference reefs are evaluated with respect to each other to determine whether they meet each relative standard, and the total number of relative standards met by each reef is tallied and compared. And this slide summarizes the performance of the 11 relative standards. A green dot indicates the standard was met. A red dot indicates the standard was not met. So you can see that in 2021, Wheeler North Reef met 9 out of the 11 standards compared to San Mateo kelp, which met 7, and the barn kelp, which met 10. So Wheeler North Reef met more standards than the lower performing reference reefs. And as a result, it met the mitigation requirement for relative performance standards in 2021. Okay, now I want to turn to absolute performance standards. These must be met every year for the Wheeler North Reef to receive mitigation credit. And there are two absolute standards, one for hard substrate that requires that at least 90% of the exposed hard substrate at the time of construction must remain available for attachment of reef biota at the Wheeler North Reef. And the other absolute standard is for undesirable or invasive species and requires that the important functions of the reef shall not be impaired by undesirable or invasive species. This evaluation standard is based on the value measured for the current year or the 4-year running average or 3-year running average, as the case may be, calculated for the current year and the previous 3 years, whichever is higher. Okay, so this is a brief run through of how we determine the area of hard substrate. The footprint area of hard substrate on the Wheeler North Reef, phases one and two, is measured by sonar every 5 years. And this is denoted by A. The percent cover of exposed rock on the reef is measured by divers. And this is denoted by P. And then we calculate the area of exposed rock as the product of A times P. There are a number of substrate categories. There are actually 9 substrate categories that we sample. And the first 5 of these are what we consider to be hard substrate, ranging from bedrock to cobble. We compare the area of exposed rock to that measured shortly after reef construction in 2009 to determine whether 90% or more is still available for reef biota in a particular year. So this graph shows the area of hard substrate by year on the left, and the cumulative area of hard substrate on the right, the bar graph on the right. And both of these graphs show the initial as-built area of hard substrate as the solid horizontal line and the 90% standard as the dashed line. And what we find is that the Wheeler North Reef was actually, since 2017, has actually had more hard substrate than initially in the initial design. And this is probably due to erosion of soft substrate that can cover the reef, or redistribution of the rock material that comprises the reef. So this standard was met for hard substrate in 2021. Okay, next I want to turn to the performance standard for undesirable and invasive species. The requirement is that they shall not impair the reef function. Undesirable species are species that naturally occur in the region, but that can achieve very high densities that might impair the function of the reef. And invasive species are non-native species that can also potentially have a negative impact on the functioning of the reef. There are two invasive species that we look at, the green alga Caulerpa prolifera and the brown alga Sargassum horneri. Primary production and secondary production of reef, in addition to the abundance of these, we look at the potential effect of these species on giant kelp and production and secondary production of reef fishes. So this slide shows the change over time in the percent cover on rock of sea fans at 3 kelp beds. And what you can see is the percent cover of sea fans is increasing disproportionately at the Wheeler North Reef compared to the reference reefs. So this is a potential concern that sea fans could impair important reef functions. And if we look at sea urchins, on the other hand, we see that sea urchin abundance is very consistently low over time, less than 1 per meter squared. And so at this time, there is little concern that sea urchins are impairing important functions of the reef. And so the next two slides, there are 2 points on these next 2 slides to evaluate potential impairment of sea fans. And the first has to do with the primary production, net primary production of giant kelp. And on the 2 graphs, you can see a number of dots. Each dot indicates a 1 transect. And so you can see the potential relationship between net primary production and the percent cover of sea fans. And if we look at 2021, there is in fact a slight negative correlation between sea fan cover and kelp production, which suggests there may be some impairment. However, if we look at the running average in 2021, there is no correlation. Another way of looking at this is to actually look at net primary production at the three reefs over time. So the time series is on the left. And what you can see is that generally speaking, net primary production at the Wheeler North Reef is either greater or within the values seen at the two reference reefs. And if we look at the running average, we see that in 2021, the running average at Wheeler North Reef was actually greater than at the two reference reefs. And so we conclude from this that there is no compelling evidence that CFANs impaired kelp primary production. Next, turning to the potential negative impact on reef fish production, we look at the production of reef fish grams per meter squared per year, again, as a function of CFAN percent cover on rock. And what we see is for 2021 and for the running average in 2021, there is no correlation between CFAN cover and secondary production of reef fishes in 2021. And again, if we do as we did for kelp and we actually look at fish production over the years at the three reefs, we see that fish production at the Wheeler North Reef is generally between values, intermediate between values at the two reference reefs. And we also see this in the running average in 2021. So from these analyses, we conclude that there is no evidence that CFANs impaired reef fish production. Next, turning to the potential impacts of invasive species. Again, Caulerpa, the green alga, and the non-native Sargassum horneri. And we saw no non-native benthic macroalgae on the Wheeler North Reef in 2021 and conclude that there is no evidence that invasive non-native benthic species have impaired important ecological functions of the Wheeler North Reef. Okay, so the in conclusion, there is no compelling evidence that undesirable native species or invasive non-native species adversely affected the important functions of the reef. We will continue to monitor the abundance of CFANs and their potential impacts on the primary production of giant kelp going forward. So the standard, absolute standard for undesirable and invasive species was met in 2021. Next, I want to turn to two other absolute performance standards that are based on accumulation of mitigation credit on an annual basis. And these two standards have to do with the giant kelp area and the fish standing stock. So the annual standing stock of fish and the acreage of giant kelp on the Wheeler North Reef are measured each year and summed over time until they reach a cumulative total that is equivalent to the annual target for each of these categories times the number of years of SONG's operation, which is 32 years. Accumulation of kelp acreage and fish standing stock began in 2019. So we're looking at 2019, 2020, and 21 for these two standards. We estimate the area of giant kelp on each of the 149 transects. We record the density of adult giant kelp, which are adults are defined as individuals with eight or more fronds. We determine whether there are four or more adult plants, greater than four adult plants in each transect, and we calculate the proportion of transects with more than four adult plants. And we multiply that proportion by the acreage of the Wheeler North Reef, which currently is at 373 acres, to get the estimated area of giant kelp. This slide, the two graphs on this slide shows on the left-hand side, the actual area of giant kelp per year. And the dashed line at the top is the 150 acre design target, the annual design target. And you can see that acreage of kelp has fluctuated over time. It's greatest in 2021. And you can see on the right is the accumulation of giant kelp area. The dotted horizontal line is the mitigation requirement of 4,800 acres, which is 150 acres times 32. Wheeler North Reef earned 47 acres of credit in 2021, and the cumulative total in 2021 is 84 acres of area of giant kelp area. In addition, I'm now turning to reef fish. We evaluate the standing stock of reef fish by applying species-specific length-weight relationships to fish density and size collected by divers. We get biomass density, the grams per meter squared, and we scale up these estimates of fish biomass per meter squared to the footprint area of the Wheeler North Reef, which is 373 acres. And so these graphs are similar to what I showed for kelp area. On the left are the annual fish standing stock tons, the 28-ton annual design criterion is shown with the dotted line at the top. And on the right, we see the cumulative fish biomass and the mitigation requirement, which is 896 tons of standing stock. Wheeler North Reef earned 28 tons of fish standing stock in 2021 and resulting in an accumulative total of 68 tons of fish standing stock. Okay, so for relative performance standards and absolute performance standards for the hard substrate and invasive and undesirable species, 1 year of mitigation credit is given for each year that Wheeler North Reef meets all of these performance standards. And the fulfillment of the mitigation requirement will occur when the number of years of mitigation credit accrued by the Wheeler North equals the total years of the operation of SONGS units 2 and 3, which is 32 years. Regarding the absolute performance standards for giant kelp area and standing stock and fish standing stock, each of these performance standards is evaluated independently. Fulfillment of the mitigation requirement for each will occur when the total accrued acres of giant kelp or the tons of fish standing stock equal the targeted value, 150 acres for kelp or 28 tons for fish, times the total number of years of operation of SONGS units 2 and 3, which is 32 years. So this slide summarizes where we are in the earned mitigation credit. So for 2021, the relative performance standards passed, the absolute standard for hard substrate and undesirable invasive species passed. So years received in 2021, Wheeler North Reef received 1 year of credit. It also received credit for 2019 and 2020. So the total number of years of credit earned is 3. The number of years of credit required is 32. And the number of years credit still needed is 29. Turning to the cumulative absolute standards of giant kelp area, 2021, the cumulative credit was 84 acres. The credit required was 4,800 acres. And the credit still needed is 4,716 acres. For fish, 28 tons occurred in 2021. Cumulative credit is 68 acres in 2021, 896 tons of credit are required, and the credit needed for reef fish standing stock is 828 tons. That concludes my presentation, and I'm now gonna open it up to questions and comments on the performance monitoring results. See, I should stop share or should I keep share?
So if anyone is interested in asking a question, please raise your hand. I don't see anyone in the chat right now who has asked a question.
There's a hand raised from Chris Goldblatt.
Okay, so we're now going to take a question from Chris. Chris, I am now bringing you into the meeting. You may need to unmute yourself, and please remember to introduce yourself to the group. Dave, are you able to bring Chris in?
Chris, you are unmuted. You can speak right now.
Am I reading? Can you guys hear me?
You're kind of breaking up a little bit, but go ahead.
How about now? Is that good?
Yeah.
Oh, okay. Well, first of all, thank you very much. This is quite exciting to see such progress. And thank you, Dan and Steve, for your continued contribution to society's understanding of how the kelp dynamics work on a reef of this nature. It's truly unique in the world. So I just have two questions for you. The term production that you went over earlier, and I see that the slide is pretty clear. It says that there was actual production that occurred. So if you could define for us what you mean by production, and is your team willing to take a position that the Wheeler North Reef is actually creating net positive reduction? That's the first part. The second part of the question is, I see that on the barn kelp, it had a greater kelp density when the kelp was less on the Wheeler North Reef. Do you think that the size of the actual holdfasts on the barn kelp had anything to do with that, because the surface area of what it's attached to is larger, the horizontal ledges and things like that, versus the smaller surface area, the quarry rock might create smaller holdfasts, and therefore you might have less kelp in certain areas as a result of that? Those are my two questions.
Well, production is the grams per meter squared per year. So that's the measure of production. And I'm a little confused. So you were saying that the kelp on the barn kelp was, can you repeat your second point, Chris?
Right. I see that when you were comparing, I think it was the relative standards, the barn kelp had better coverage 1 year than the Wheeler North Reef. And I was asking if you think that has to do with the fact that the holdfasts themselves may grow to a larger size on the barn kelp because the actual physical structure that it's attached to is larger itself than the individual quarry rock. So you get a bigger holdfast that might withstand more storms and things like that.
So Chris, what we saw on the artificial reefs with respect to kelp was that all three of them really declined to a low in 2020. Yeah. And what happened in 2021, we tended to get a decent amount of recruitment on barn kelp, but not so much on San Mateo or Wheeler North Reef. And so what we saw in 2021 was just a higher density of adult plants at barn kelp compared to Wheeler North Reef and San Mateo. And we're seeing, and you'll hear in the next presentation, we're seeing greater recruitment on Wheeler North Reef in this past year. So we're hoping that will increase as well. Mm-hmm. With regards to your question regarding fish production, that's what you're referring to the first time when you talked about production in your first question.
Right.
You know, the way we measure fish production, it really is looking at growth of the somatic growth of the fish, which is based on looking at increments in otoliths, the ear bones in the fish. We also look at gonadal growth, which is based on reproductive tissue. This is all work that's being led by Mark Steele. And then we also combine that with the actual biomass of the fish on the reef. So we're really looking at the existing biomass and how much of that biomass is increasing through growth and production. And so, yeah, the fact that we have decent amount of production, or as high a fish production at Wheeler North Reef as surrounding reefs, suggests that we are in fact getting increases in production on the Wheeler North Reef. We also, the fact that fish recruited fairly rapidly to the Wheeler North Reef suggests we also got, you know, attraction as well of larger fish. But The recruitment of new fish to Wheeler North Reef, coupled with production of growth and somatic growth and gonadal growth, suggests there indeed is a increase in net primary production of fish on the reef.
Thank you very much for that, Dan.
I'm not seeing anyone raising their hand or in the chat right now. We'll give it a few seconds more and then we'll move on to the next talk. Kat, why don't you go ahead?
Okay, great. Thanks, Jonna. So in the previous talk, we reported on the ability of Wheeler North Reef to meet a series of performance standards. And that is all per the SONGS Coastal Development Permit. So in this talk, we're going to focus on the temporal and spatial patterns of species abundance on Wheeler North Reef for the three phases, which all vary in age. And so our hope is that in understanding the trajectory of phases one and two, we can then better understand or gain insight into the future trajectories of phase three, which is the more newly constructed younger reef phase. And so for this talk, we're focusing on kelp and reef fish because these are key components upon which Wheeler North Reef is judged, as you have seen from the previous talk. But then we're also going to spend a bit of time talking about the California spiny lobster, given its importance as a key predator in kelp forest systems, and that it is the target species of commercial and recreational fisheries. And then we're going to end with a review diving a little bit deeper into the CFAN data, because as Steve mentioned in the previous talk, these CFANs can form these dense aggregations that then can exclude kelp and other benthic species, thereby impairing important ecological functions. Okay, so this is going to be a little bit of review from Dan's talk, but it's important context, so I'm going to quickly go over this. So phase one was the 25-acre experimental reef that was designed to test different types of reef configurations and bottom benthic material and cover types or cover percentages. And so this was done across 56 40 by 40 meter modules that are shown as the pink squares here. And this was a phase that was built in 1999. And the results from phase one informed the design of phase two, which was the mitigation reef. This was a 150 acre reef that was spread across 18 polygons shown in green here in this figure. And this was constructed in 2008. And then in 2019, Wheeler North Reef's mitigation reef was expanded to increase the standing stock of reef fishes and kelp area. And so in 2019, across 11 polygons that totaled 125 acres, shown in white here. This was the first portion of the expansion. And then in 2020, an additional 9 polygons that covered 73 acres were added in the next year. And so to date, as Dan mentioned, Wheeler North Reef now covers 373 acres of seafloor, which stretch along a 4.5 mile stretch of coastline. Okay, so you saw these figures in Steve's talk as well, and this is basically the foundation for this portion of the workshop. So Wheeler North Reef is judged upon whether or not it's able to meet this design target of either 28 tons of reef fish standing stock or 150 acres of adult kelp. And so for this part of the workshop, I'm going to break down each of the components that from which these two absolute standards are derived. So starting first with fish standing stock. So you have abundance or density data, which coupled with size gives you the biomass of reef fish per unit area. You then scale that to the entire footprint area of Wheeler North Reef, and that gives you standing stock. So I'm going to walk through each of these components now, starting with reef fish abundance. But first I want to orient you to these graphs because you're going to see a whole bunch of them and they're pretty consistent. So it's important that you understand the orientation. So for each of these graphs, the x-axis is time, which is for this one extending from 2009 to 2021. So that's 1 year following the construction of phase two, or 10 years following the construction of phase one, to 1 year following the construction of phase three. And for each of the time series, we have phase one color-coded in purple, phase two in green, and phase three in white. And we've indicated the number of transects that are sampled in parentheses in the legend in the upper left-hand corner. And so for this particular figure, we're plotting resident fish density. This is mean resident fish density, measured as the number of individuals per 100 meters squared, plus or minus the standard error of the mean. And so what we see is that generally through time, resident fish density is highest on phase one. And within years, the reef fish density on phase one is also more variable. And this is likely driven by the fact that it's a relatively small sample size with only 12 transects monitored. And as you remember from the previous slides about the configuration of phase one, it's made up of a different, of multiple different types of designs for reef designs. And so reef fish density on phase two since about 2012 has been relatively stable, and in 2021 was higher than phase one, with the lowest values of fish densities recorded on phase three in 2021. So next I'm going to show you some heat maps. So first, similar to what I did earlier, I'm going to orient you to these heat maps because you're going to see a whole bunch of them. So we have plotted phases one and two separate from phase three. So you're going to see them as two separate panels. And at each of these figures, there's a scale at the top of the map that represent where cooler colors represent lower values and warmer colors represent higher values. And so for mean fish density for phases one and two, we see this really clear pattern where there is higher densities of reef fishes on the offshore deeper portions of Wheeler North Reef. For phase three, we don't see any such consistent spatial pattern. And generally phase three reef fish density is quite lower. Moving on to reef fish size, we see that through time, reef fish size has remained relatively constant, ranging from about 18 to 24 centimeters. And we see when we look at the spatial distribution of reef fishes, that there isn't that same uniformity or clear pattern of reef fish size that we saw for reef fish density. It's much more patchy and varies unpredictably. And this is the case for both phases one, two, and three. Moving on now to reef fish biomass. So you'll notice that reef fish biomass follows the similar pattern that reef fish density did. And so this suggests that reef fish density rather than reef fish size is the primary driver of reef fish biomass. And we see that similar to reef fish density, fish biomass is generally higher on phase one and more variable than on phase two, with phase two generally increasing very gradually from about, or not very gradually, but increasing gradually from about 2012 to 2021, where it was very similar to phase one. And the lowest values in that year were observed on phase three. But if we plot reef fish biomass as a function of reef age, we can compare reef fish biomass on phases two and three when they were both similar ages or at a similar stage in their development. So that's what we've done on this bottom panel here. And what you can see from this is that 1 year following the construction of both phases two and three, reef fish biomass is nearly identical. And so given that these two phases are similar in design, if phase three is to follow a similar trajectory to phase two, we would expect reef fish biomass to double in the next few years. Looking at the spatial distribution of reef fish biomass, we see that unlike reef fish density, it also does not have that clear offshore pattern and is rather patchy and varies significantly with many of the polygons less than 5 grams per meter squared. And then for phase three, generally speaking, reef fish biomass is quite low, with the exception of this southernmost polygon on phase three, where a giant sea bass slammed through one of the two transects. Okay, so recall that fish standing stock is reef fish biomass scaled to the entire area, footprint area of Wheeler North Reef, which to review from 2009 to about 2019, 2020 was 175 acres and only included phases one and two. And then from 2020 to 2021 was 373 acres with the addition of the phase three expansion reef. And so this plot is showing fish standing stock broken down by each of the three phases so that you can see the relative contribution of each phase to total fish standing stock within a single year. And so a couple important things to note, in 2021, this was the first year that Wheeler North Reef met its 28 ton design target. And it appears that the biomass of reef fish on phase three is additive and that there's no evidence that standing stock of fish on phase three is having a negative effect on the standing stocks of either phases one or two. So to compare reef fish standing stock across the natural and mitigation reefs, one way to do this is to scale it to the area of Wheeler North Reef, which, as a reminder, is indicated here below the x-axis. And so when we do that, what we see is that Wheeler North Reef, in terms of standing stock, has consistently been within the projected range of the nearby natural reefs, being higher than San Mateo and lower than Barn, consistently through time. And finally, sizes and densities of the species that make up standing stock can really vary depending on species composition. And since the intent of Wheeler North Reef was to build a reef that could support communities that would resemble the natural reefs, really looking into the data with respect to species composition is important here. And so what we've plotted here is the proportion of total biomass for the three phases of Wheeler North Reef and the two natural reefs for these five key species. And these same species accounted for between 42 and 60% of the fish standing stock on all the reefs. And so these species are the medium-sized black perch and Garibaldi, which feed on benthic invertebrates. And then larger species such as kelp bass and barred sand bass, which feed on fishes, and the California sheephead, which feeds on large bottom-dwelling invertebrates. Okay, so that wraps up the fish component of this talk. Moving on to the components of how we get to the area of medium to high density kelp. So small plants recruit and then they're to the reef, and then their growth and survivorship is what ultimately determines the adult density and distribution. When you scale that to the entire footprint area of Wheeler North Reef, you get the area of medium to high density kelp. So starting first with recruits, one thing to note in this series of graphs is that now our x-axis is extended from 2000, which is 1 year following the construction of phase one, through 2021, which is 1 year after the construction of phase three. And so we define recruits as plants that are between 2 centimeters and less than 1 meter tall. And what we see is that 1 year following construction for phases one and for phase two, so that's 2000 and 2009, we see these recruitment pulses. And we see a less visible, but visible pulse in 2021 on phase three. And you'll notice that there's very little recruitment in between these pulses. And I want to just bring your attention to this 2015 pulse on phases one and two, which will come into play in later slides. So when we look at the spatial distribution of kelp recruits on phases one, two, and three, we see that they vary quite a bit from polygon to polygon, with some polygons less than 4 recruits per 100 meters squared, and others with 70 to 260 recruits per 100 meters squared. So there's a really high spatial variability. So the growth and survival of kelp recruits is what ultimately determines the density of subadults, which are defined as plants that are greater than 1 meter tall with less than 8 fronds. And what we see is that within the years and immediately after these recruitment pulses, we see these peaks or these spikes in subadult densities. So here's one clear spike here and another here for phase one. And then less pronounced, but still quite high, or not quite high, but these little peaks in subadult giant kelp were observed on phase two. Following these recruitment pulses in 2010, 2016, and 2021. And so with pretty high relative to phase one, subadult densities on phases two and three, which is important here because phases two and three comprise 93% of the total area of Wheeler North Reef. So these sorts of dynamics are important. When we look at the spatial distribution of subadult kelp across phases one, two, and three, we see that similar to the kelp recruits, there isn't any consistent or uniform pattern with respect to subadult densities. They vary quite a bit across Wheeler North Reef, and there's no predictability to their patterns. When looking at adult kelp, which is defined as plants that are greater than 1 meter tall with eight or more fronds, we see that 1 to 2 years following construction on phases one and phase two, we see these peaks in adult giant kelp. And then following these peaks, there's natural thinning and attrition of the kelp forest. And then pointing out quickly here that this little peak in, or this little increase in the air, density of adult giant kelp in 2017 is likely related to that 2015 recruitment pulse that I pointed out earlier, which had a subsequent increase in subadults, and thus there was more kelp in 2017, likely driven by that. So the Songs Coastal Development Permit defines medium to high density kelp as having more than four plants per 100 meters squared, as Steve mentioned. And you'll notice that throughout the last 21 years, most years, phases one and two are above this value. And this is the value that that will still give you a dense canopy. And the exception to that being recent years. And so when we look at the spatial distribution of adult giant kelp density in 2021 on phases one, two, and three, we see that most of these polygons had less than four plants per 100 meters squared, with a few exceptions, one being this northern polygon on phase three that had 65 plants per 100 meters squared. Okay, so here we are plotting, similar to what we did with standing stock, we're plotting the area of adult kelp broken down by each of the phases. And again, this is all scaled to the footprint area of Wheeler North Reef, which, to remind you, from 2009 to 2019 was 175 acres, and from 2020 to 2021 was 373 acres. And what we see is that from 2010 to 2015, nearly every acre of Wheeler North Reef supported medium to high density adult kelp. And this is despite adult densities, as shown in the previous figure, declining from 2010 to about 2016. And since 2016, kelp area has fluctuated erratically, reaching its lowest values in 2020. And in 2021, phase three contributed 13 of the 47 acres of kelp at Wheeler North Reef, and phase two contributed the remaining 34 acres, or 73%. So when we look at the size structure of giant kelp at Wheeler North Reef in 2021, as plotted here, we have density measured as the number of individuals per 100 meters squared on the y-axis, and recruits are plotted in the top panel, subadults in the middle panel, and adults on the bottom panel. And we have broken it down by each of the three phases, separating out phase three that was built in 2019, covering 125 acres, and the portion of phase three that was built in 2020 that covers 73 acres. And what we see is that there were substantial numbers of recruit and subadult giant kelp in 2021, especially in these larger phase two and three polygons. And like I said earlier, this is really important and potentially promising because phases two and three polygons make up 93% of the total area of Wheeler North Reef. And so if conditions for kelp growth and survivorship are favorable, then there should be a resulting increase in the density of adult kelp in 2022. And so here, returning to this figure here, just to say that a substantial increase in the density of adult kelp in the phase 2 and 3 polygons in 2022 should lead to a substantial increase in the area of medium to high density kelp on Wheeler North Reef. And so we will be watching this very closely over the next field season to see if that is indeed the case. So to compare the area of medium to high density kelp at Wheeler North Reef to the two natural reefs, this gives us, there's two benefits to doing this. The first is that it allows us to understand the relative ability of Wheeler North Reef to be able to meet this 150 acre design target. And then it also gives us the insight of whether or not these erratic fluctuations that we've been seeing since 2016 are specific to Wheeler North Reef or more characteristic of the region at large. And so what we've done here is we've taken the area of adult kelp and scaled it for each of the sites to the size or area of Wheeler North Reef. And when we do that, we see that one, Wheeler North Reef has typically had as much or has had as much or been within the range of the nearby natural reefs with respect to adult kelp. And we also see that these oscillations are observed across all of the reefs, suggesting that this is more of a regional phenomena. And then in 2021, we saw a substantial increase in the area of adult kelp at Barn, which is the more distant of the two reference natural reefs. And a more moderate but similar increase in the area of adult kelp at Wheeler North Reef and San Mateo. Okay, so switching gears to the California spiny lobster. So the Songs Coastal Development Permit does not have a performance standard that explicitly calls out the California spiny lobster, but we have a lot of data that from the performance monitoring that we can extract lobster densities from. And so we can look at lobster densities through time since 2000 and see how they vary across Wheeler North Reef and the two reference reefs. And when we do that, when we plot lobster density as a function of time, we see that from about 2000 to 2011, lobster densities remained relatively constant. And then starting in 2012, there was a regional increase in lobster densities, but that increase was 2 to 3 times higher at Wheeler North Reef. And so, curious to look at how those lobsters were distributed spatially, we see that lobster density varies rather unpredictably across space along Wheeler North Reef, with densities, many of these polygons averaging around 2 individuals per 100 meters squared, whereas this large polygon from phase 2, just south of the San Clemente Pier, had 11 individuals per 100 meters squared. Okay, moving on to sea fans. So as mentioned before, the Songs Coastal Development Permit does have a performance standard related to undesirable levels of native species that have the potential to impair important ecological functions. And as we've mentioned many times so far today, sea fans are a potential species of concern given that they can form these dense aggregations that then exclude kelp and other benthic species. And so what we've done here is we've plotted percent cover of sea fans on rock through time from 2000 to 2021. And what we see is that there was this increase in sea fan cover on rock on phase 1 to about 20% in 2007. And then there appears to be some, maybe a mortality event that caused that cover to decrease. And since 2009, there's been no appreciable increase in sea fan cover on rock on phase 1. On phase 2, on the other hand, sea fan densities have been gradually increasing to a level similar to that observed on phase 1 in 2021. When we look at the spatial distribution of sea fans on Wheeler North Reef, we see that they are cover tends to be higher in the offshore portion of Wheeler North Reef. Looking next at sea fan density, we see that the patterns are somewhat similar to what we saw on the previous slide for percent cover on rock, that the densities of sea fans on phase 1 had increased and then following a mortality event had nearly halved. And then now they are relatively stable. and have not changed too much, whereas there has been a gradual increase in the density of sea fans on phase two. When we look at the spatial distribution again of sea fans on phases one and two, we see that similar 2% cover, the densities of sea fans are highest on the offshore portion of Wheeler North Reef. Okay, so to summarize, the contribution of the phase three expansion reef to the standing stock of reef fish and the area of medium to high density kelp appears to be additive. And so if the trajectory of community development of phase three follows that of the similarly constructed phase two, then standing stock of reef fish and the area of adult giant kelp should increase over the next few years. With respect to lobsters, it appears that the design and location of Wheeler North Reef is favorable for supporting populations of the spiny lobster. And finally, with respect to sea fans, the coverage and density of sea fans on phase one has not continued to increase in its 22 years of existence. And this suggests that sea fans are not anticipated to reach undesirable levels on phases two or three of Wheeler North Reef anytime soon. And so with that, we'd be happy to take any questions, and I'll leave this up.
Again, we are watching for raised hands or any questions in the chat box. But I guess our speakers, our contract scientists, have answered all your questions today. So, but we would be happy to field any questions you have. And I will mention that you are, Dan had told you where at the bottom of the screen, you can see the website for the Marine Science Institute's Songs Marine Mitigation site. You can get contact information for us there and send us an email and ask any questions that you think of following today's workshop.
Chris Goldblatt has a question.
Oh, Chris, please, I'm now bringing you into the meeting. You may need to unmute yourself and please just introduce yourself to the group.
Yeah, hi, Chris Goldblatt with the Fishery Project again. Thank you, Kat, for a wonderful presentation there. Just a quick question. If you had to pick a period of time to call the kelp cycle, you hear people say that it's a 20-year cycle or it's a 10-year cycle. I realize erratic El Ninos don't help, but based on that very intimate data that's been compiled, it looks like about a 10-year cycle of some sort. And I was just wondering if you might want to comment on that between the ebbs and the flows of the big picture of it dying off and recruiting and coming back and all of that.
I think the best option here would be to punt that one to Dan. So I'm going to let Dan answer that one.
Chris, you know, all we can really do is speak to the data there. And what appears to happen is when the canopy disappears, that opens up light on the bottom and you get a recruitment event. That recruitment event seems to lead to, you know, adult densities, a canopy that persists for 5 or 6 years. As it gradually declines, you know, that opens up light on the bottom for more recruits. If the light on the bottom that is needed for the new recruits is also determined by the clarity of the water. And so just because the canopy goes away doesn't always mean there's gonna be a recruitment event. And so the times between when the canopy disappears and when we do get new recruitment, that can be really variable, at least based on our data and based on the information that were the studies that were done during the initial impact assessment phase, where Tom Dean and Larry Deischer, the people that worked on that back then, they really identified what they call these periods of recruitment windows, where proper conditions of light and nutrients and temperature on the bottom happened every couple of years in the absence of a kelp canopy down there. And so, but it looks like once you get a canopy of kelp, that the adults produced from that cohort persist for on order about 5 years or so before they thin to a density that would allow new recruits to come in.
Thank you very much.
Okay, so now I see that David Asti with SCE has his hand up. So David, I'm bringing you into the meeting. You may need to unmute yourself and please introduce yourself to the group.
Now, can you hear me?
Yes.
Excellent. Okay, good. First off, I'd like to say nice presentations, folks. Really, really well done. Steve, Dan, Jonah, nice to see you all. Look forward to the day when I can see you all in person again. just a quick question. I mean, I see the lobster and the kelp variability. And again, being a geologist and not a marine scientist, I have to ask you all, is that normal cycle stuff? Is that climate change? Is that El Nino? Is it all three? And then the second part of that question, if a significant portion of that is climate change, have we as a team, because I mean, this thing really is a partnership, have we contemplated the, if it is climate change, have we contemplated the impacts to some of the standards that we have for success with the expanded reef now? And so just your thoughts.
David, I'll take a stab at that, and then Kat and Steve can, or others can comment. I think in the case of lobster, that trend that we've been seeing since 2012, I believe it is, that increase, we've seen that in our long-term studies here at Santa Barbara. So that seems to be a trend that is region-wide, not just related to not just occurring in the area of the Wheeler North Reef, but probably throughout most of Southern California. And I'd probably venture to say Baja as well. And lobster, they reach their kind of northern bounds up around Santa Barbara, a little north. And so they're really more of a, warm water species. So it could be that, gradual warming has led to higher recruitment and increased density. So that very may well be related to climate change. With regards to the kelp, the warm water that we got, the warmest water was in 2014, 2015. And we got a pulse of kelp recruitment in 2015 that led to an increase in adults. I believe it peaked again in 2016. So that was after that warm water event, but then it declined and reached a low in 2020. And why it declined the way it did when temperatures actually decreased at that point, we don't really know. There wasn't much recruitment. We saw virtually no recruitment until a little bit last, or in 2020 and a bit more in 2021. Unfortunately, we don't collect a lot of oceanographic data on this project, so we don't really have data specific to our area. That's a good question. To what extent things are changing as a result of climate? I will let Jonna maybe talk about how the permit is equipped to deal with that. I'm not sure that there's provisions in it now, but how that would work with the commission is probably something John is better able to comment on.
Well, I think the fact that we have reference reefs in it, we could determine whether it's a regional phenomena or not would help us to determine that. But the conditions, special conditions, they provide for that, the fixed standards and the relative standards. So I think that we were covered with what might happen in the future.
I think when it comes to, you know, like Jonna said, the relative standards, you know, it really shouldn't make much difference if it's a climate change thing, because we're comparing them to the nearby sites. With right. regards to the fixed standards for kelp and fish biomass, if I had to make a guess, it probably, what it will likely do is affect the species composition of the fish assemblage, but the extent to which it actually affects the standing stock, I mean, it's really hard to say. I don't know of too many studies that have shown that the warmer water has resulted in a decline in fish biomass as much as a change in the species composition. Clearly, if warm water comes in and kelp responds adversely to it, it would really have an effect on the kelp absolute standard for sure.
That's true. And then I think we would have to, you know, have a huddle and look at what's happening in the region and take that into consideration.
I just wanted to add one thing to that, and that's that this might be a bigger concern if we were at the limits of giant kelp range already. And so that, you know, potentially with climate change, that we could expect the kelp would completely disappear, but that's not the case because kelp goes down to Baja. And so it seems less likely to be a big concern to me.
Sounds good. Thank you very much. I appreciate the answers.
So not seeing any hands up in the chat or any hands up or any questions in the chat. So 3:05, we were scheduled to be here till 3:30 and beyond. So don't be shy if you have a question. Well, I think we can call it a successful public workshop this year. Thank you for your participation. And again, if you have more questions, please go to the website at UCSB. And thank you very much for participating. So I think we'll go ahead, David, and we'll end the workshop.